Hey, good morning, Harvest family. Glad we get to be together. Glad we get to worship this morning. My name is Larry Geisler. I get to serve in leading our Harvest Students Ministry, Harvest Young Adults Ministry. Little plug, student ministry is back tonight, Sunday nights, 5 o'clock, if you want to come join us. But it's great to have you all with us. If this is your first time at Harvest Bible Chapel, we just want to give you a special welcome. We're glad that you're here. Don't know how it is that you came here, how God brought you here, but we want to connect with you. If you have questions about our church, if you're looking for ways to be involved here, if you just want to know what this is all about, I'll be out in our lobby after this gathering, and I'd love to chat with you. You can meet some of our other staff, and actually right after the service, we have Discover Harvest, which would be a great time to come and learn about what our church does, and so we'd love to have you for that. Just come chat with me after the service. For everyone here, it's our goal, just as a church staff, to care for you and to help you become the disciple of Jesus that God desires you to be. There's a few ways that we do that, and some of them are really simple, just on our app, the Church Center app. If you don't have it yet, you can just look it up, Google Church Center app, and there's a few helpful things on there. One you're going to find is just an opportunity to check in, so we'd ask you all to do that right now. Check in, let us know you're here, because it helps us, so when you're not here, we can reach out to you, say, hey, we miss you. You should be at church gathering with your friends, with your family here. Like, we want to see you. So go ahead and check in. Also, if there's anything that you're lifting up to the Lord, anything that you're walking through, any difficulty in your life, just something that you're praying towards, we have a place where you can submit prayer requests. Our staff prays for every one of the prayer requests that come through, that are sent through the app. We want to pray with you. We want to celebrate when God answers prayer. So please go ahead and submit your prayer request there as well. In a couple of weeks, we have an awesome opportunity to gather as a church family in an experience we're calling the Journey of Generosity. We know if we are in Christ, if we have seen the grace of God, we've seen how our Father in heaven has been generous enough to give us his only son to die in our place, that we would have eternal life and we would have relationship with him. We know that our God is good and he is generous and he has saved us, and we're thankful. And so we want to reflect his character. We want to reflect who he is to the world around us. And that means that we should be a generous people. Yeah? That's exactly what it means. And so we're going to learn as a church what it means to be generous. So on September 6th and 7th, this is a Friday night and Saturday morning event, totally free. We're going to gather here and we're going to go through some studies, listen to some stories, and learn what it means for us to exhibit generosity in our lives. So what does it mean for me to be generous in my marriage? What does it mean for me to be generous with my time? What does it mean to be generous with my personal finance? What does it mean to be generous with my business? Anything in your life, learning how to look at it through a lens of, I could be generous with what God has given me. And so it's totally free. We're going to provide dinner on Friday night. We're going to provide breakfast on Saturday morning. The only thing we ask you to do is to sign up. So you can go to harvestbible.org and register so that we can make a place for you. We can make sure we have food for you. We would love to see everyone in the room join us right here for Journey of Generosity in a couple of weeks. Before we get started this morning, I want to take some time to pray. We're going to pray that God would work through this time, but we're also going to pray for some good friends, Gospel Preaching Church in the area, which is The Orchard in Arlington Heights. We thank God for them because they're preaching the gospel and they're reaching their community for Christ. So let's take some time and pray for them and pray for God to work through this gathering. God, we thank you so much for who you are. You are the Father who gives us so many good gifts. You are not stingy with us, Lord. You have blessed us beyond what we can comprehend. We thank you for breath in our lungs this morning, with which we can give you praise. And Lord, we thank you that there are others around us who are praising you as well. We thank you for The Orchard, and we thank you for their faithfulness to teach your word. We thank you for their commitment to make disciples. We thank you for their influence in their community. And God, we just ask that you would bless them and have favor upon them? Would you encourage them this morning? We pray for Pastor Colin that you would speak through him, your Holy Spirit, empower him and lead him. And God, would you give them favor in their community? Would you open doors that they would be able to have interactions with people who don't know you, who need to know you? And that, Lord, they would have the knowledge, they would have the courage and the boldness to proclaim the truth of Jesus to whoever they encounter. God, we thank you for them, and God, we thank you for this church. It's such a blessing that we get to come here and we get to praise your name. So Lord, would you be exalted and glorified in all that we do today through our worship, through the preaching of your word. This is all because of you, and this is all for you. So we give you the praise and the honor and the glory in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, church, let's go ahead and stand up. Let's praise the Lord together.
The heavens declare the glory of God, and the sky above proclaims his handiwork. Day to day pours out speech, and night to night reveals knowledge. There is no speech, nor are there words whose voice is not heard. Their voice goes out through all the earth, and their words to the end of the world. They sing the glory of who God is, wordless, but God has given us words, and those words are holy, holy, holy are you, Lord God Almighty. So let's sing that together. Holy, 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 Lord.
Blessed. there's freedom in this place. It feels like this is what heaven sounds like. We praise you, we praise you. Oh, this is what living looks like. Oh, this is what freedom feels like. Oh, this is what heaven sounds like. We praise you, we praise you. This is what living looks like. This is what freedom feels like. This is what heaven sounds like. We praise you, we praise you. This is what living looks like. This is what freedom feels like. This is what heaven sounds like. We praise you, we praise. We'll see you break down every wall. We'll watch the giants fall. Oh, fear cannot survive when we praise you. The God of
I'm No matter what the season, nothing's gonna stop. Amazing time of worship we had together. Why don't you turn around and say hello to someone?
All right, Harvest, go ahead and take a seat. Guys, we have some baby dedications this week. Yeah, a great time to celebrate, right? The babies that will be dedicated today, they are not being saved today, but these parents are making the decision to train them up and raise them up in the ways of the Lord. And it says that in Proverbs 22 and 6. It says, train up your child in the way that they ought to go, and when they grow old, they will not depart far from it. And so these families are making that commitment to doing that, but we're doing it in front of our church. So our church gets to participate in this process as well by helping them to do just that, train them up in the ways of the Lord. And so first up, we have Matt and Andy. And who do we have here? Who are we dedicating today, Matt?
We're dedicating our newest one, Daniel.
And so you have chosen a verse to read over Daniel, and this is going to be his life verse or your family's life verse for him right now?
At the moment, yeah. This is, we kind of named him after the prophet Daniel, so okay. It really, the embodiment of all of it. But this is one of the verses that really stood out for us. Okay. This is Daniel chapter 4, verse 37. It says, praise and extol and honor the King of heaven, for all his works are right and his ways are just, and those who walk in pride he is able to humble.
Okay, amen. All right. Next up, we have TJ and Rebecca. TJ, who are we dedicating today?
Today we're dedicating Amy Joy, which is our third. Okay. We have Ariel and Abby. And the verse that we chose is in Psalm 25, verse 10, which says, all the paths of the Lord are steadfast love and faithfulness for those who keep his covenant and his testimonies.
Right. Amen. Amen. Man, let's give a hand for God's word for sure. Yeah. And so, Harvest, we all get to participate in this, and it is our prayer that someday these children will make a decision for themselves to follow the Lord, all right? And so, will you join me as we pray for that? Can you point your hands towards these families as we do that? Lord, we thank you for what you're doing in the lives of your people, and we thank you for these parents' commitment to training their children up in the way that they ought to go. And in that, Lord, would you help us as a church to come alongside them and support them in that? And Lord, it is our prayer that these children will take the gospel further than we could have ever imagined. I pray that they will be a light to this world and unashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ. And so, God, we just ask that you use each child in a powerful way to share the gospel of Jesus Christ. And so, God, we thank you for them. I thank you for the parents. And we ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. All right, Harvest, go ahead and, yeah. You guys can go ahead. All right, guys, you can go ahead and open up your Bible to Isaiah chapter 6 as we open up God's word this morning.
Hi, it's good to see you. I hope you're having a great late summer. It's great to have you worship together today. Before we get started studying God's word, I do want to just let you know that part of the worship that we do, of course, is in singing, and worship is a subject that, like, worship isn't just kind of what we do when we gather in church, right? We call this corporate worship. We gather together, we sing songs and we pray prayers and things. But worship is an all of life thing, right? We would all agree that when we worship God, it's not just with words or things like that. Oftentimes it's with even the stuff that's the deepest to us. And so this, you know, one of the ways that we worship God is by giving. If you are part of Harvest, this is a regular way for us to involve ourselves when we worship the Lord. We're not giving money to the church. We're giving money to Jesus, who is the Lord of the church. You remember the story about the widow's mite when Jesus tells a story. She gives this money. Actually, when she's giving this money, the two, whatever, the little shekels that she's got, little denarii that she's got, she is giving it to a really bad temple system. God's going to hold the temple system accountable for the way that they spend the money, but he commends her for the giving, for the act of giving, because it represents what's going on in her heart. And that certainly is the case for us. Christian people give to the Lord out of everything they have, including their money. So at Harvest, if you're part of our church, it's one of the things that we do. We have little boxes at the back. There's little blue boxes on the way out. If you like to give, through check or those sorts of things. Very few people do that these days because we all have electronic giving. And so because of that, we have QR codes and online giving and all of that kind of thing. If you ever are interested in finding out how it is that you can give more regularly, a lot of times people forget and things like that. I give online through a regular donation and stuff, and so it's a lot easier that way. That is something, though, for people who are part of Harvest. If you are new here, I want to let you know that your presence here is gift enough, and we're just really happy that you're here. And so together, I'd like to pray for the use of the money, that it would be God's will, and all the things that we do would be honoring to him. And second, I want to pray for our time together as we study God's word. So if you'd join me, I'd like to do that. Father, I'm thankful for your goodness. I'm thankful for the fact that we have been graced so significantly that it's because of that grace that you're asking us to respond. We don't give you anything because we're trying to earn points or merit or anything. Our merit is in Jesus, and it's the gift of our Savior who now calls us to free ourselves from what can often be the idolatry of money, and we want to give ourselves back to you. So God, I pray that you find us faithful in that. Lord, it's not a duty. I know that we sometimes feel like that. It feels like, you know, churches are always trying to grab our money, at least in our culture, that's the way we think about it. But I just pray, Lord, that here at Harvest, we would have the right thinking about it, that actually it's yours. All of it is yours. So we're giving back to you just portion of what it is that you've already given to us. It's all yours. You can use it however you want. But I pray that the money that is given into the church here, Father, that you would multiply it and that you would use it through leaders here and through others who are making decisions. Lord, I pray that it would be used for your glory and there'd be a lot of accountability and all the decisions that go into that would be made with uprightness and justice and all of, equal measures and all of that kind of stuff. Thank you that we get to study your word today. And I'm particularly thankful for this passage in Isaiah. It's been so meaningful to me over the years, and I'm thankful that you've given me an opportunity to share about it today. I pray, Lord, that those who are here would have their eyes opened and ears open to what it is that you have to say through it. I pray you find me faithful in communicating it the best I can. I pray, Lord, ultimately that hearts would be transformed, that you would grow our affections towards you, and that we'd love you more than everything else in our lives. So to that end, I pray, and I ask you now, Spirit, to come and to bless us with both your comforting and your illumination as we study your word together. In Jesus' name, amen. There's some really crazy parts of the Bible. I know you're quite aware of that. It's not actually something we talk very much about as Christians. We're supposed to pretend that, I guess it's the longer we're in church, we're supposed to pretend that the Bible is this really easy to understand book, especially when you get into some of the Old Testament passages. There are things that go on there that don't always make sense to the modern mind, at least when we sit down and we read it in one sitting. One such place actually is when the Philistines, which were the enemies of Israel, they came and they actually won a battle against Israel. And in the battle, they took the Ark of God, right? The Ark was supposed to be kind of the seat of God. It was God's presence with the people, both symbolic, but in those days, they actually believed the Ark was where God was. And so when they brought the Ark out into battle, it meant they were bringing God, Yahweh, into the battle, right? And that's why they would often win. And if you don't know, people's faces melt off and stuff when you use the Ark. Did you know? Okay. For those of you who don't know what I'm referring to, it's Raiders of the Lost Ark, which is basically another book in Scripture. So they bring this, but the Ark, they bring it into battle. And of course, they expect to win. But in this one occasion, they don't win, which is a shock to everybody in Israel. And the Philistines, they take this Ark, and when you win a battle against your competitors, you take the symbol of their god, usually a statue, usually some kind of like coins or treasures that were located in that god's worship space. You would take that stuff, you pick it up, and you take it over to your worship space and lay it, you know, into your god's temple as a sign that your god basically beat their god. And because that happened, he gets all of the spoils from the war, okay? Well, they did this, and they put it in front of their god Dagon. And they closed the door, and the next morning they woke up, and Dagon, somehow his statue had been bowing down to the Ark, which is awesome. Nobody was in there, right? And then they were like, "Ooh, that's awkward." So they picked Dagon back up. They, you know, put him in his spot. And they're like, "Well, okay, maybe he just fell over, earthquake or whatever." And then the next morning they wake up and they open the door, and Dagon's head's cut off and his hand's cut off, right? Because Yahweh doesn't like Dagon, I guess, right? And finally they're like, "This, something's going wrong." And they all start getting basically hemorrhoids. All of them get hemorrhoids. And they're freaking out because they're like, this really hurts. And it's everything is going wrong for the Philistines while the Ark is around them, okay? Because God can fight his battles even without his people, which is a really cool idea, right? Just leave God to it and he'll give everyone hemorrhoids is the moral to the story, I get. So he does. And then everywhere this Ark, so the city says, get rid of the Ark. We don't want it with us. We'll keep it in Philistia, and we'll put it in another city. They put it in another city, and everyone there gets, there's rats and hemorrhoids. And then they go to another one, and they get rats and hemorrhoids. And then they get rats. And then they're finally like, we're done with this Ark. We're going to send it back. Attach it to a cart, put it on a cart, send it back toward Israel, and give the animals just an opportunity to run off. And with it, we're going to put some golden rats. You know, we're going to fashion golden rats and then some golden hemorrhoids. No joke. This is in the Bible. We're gonna make like little statues of golden hemorrhoids. I don't know what they looked like at all, but they put those on the cart with the ark, and they were like, you know, blessings, and they sent it off. And it goes back to Israel. Okay, so Israel gets the ark. They're really excited about it, of course, because it just sort of showed up back with them. And they have to transport it now to a location that they want it. So they put it basically on their own little cart, and they start dragging it away. And as it's being dragged away, it starts to shake. You know, you go on these uneven roads, and it starts to shake. And along the way, this is what happens. David and all the house, so this is in 2 Samuel chapter 6. David and all the house of Israel were celebrating before the Lord with songs and lyres and harps and tambourines and castanets and cymbals. They're having this big party. Hey, the ark is back. And when they came to the threshing floor of Nacon, Uzzah, another great Bible name for your kids, Uzzah put out his hand to the ark of God and took hold of it. For the oxen stumbled, right? So they, and the ark starts coming off. And this guy Uzzah's like, oh, hey, I'm gonna do everybody a favor and make sure the ark doesn't fall on the ground and everything inside falls out, right? This seems like a noble work. We all agreed? Yeah, he reaches out. Oh, let me steady it a little bit. And then the anger of the Lord was kindled against Uzzah, and God struck him down there because of his error, and he died there beside the ark of God. Wait, what? He touched it. He's dead. See, I was with you in this story all the way up, right? I mean, you read this, and Sam, I was cool all the way up to the Philistines, bad guys. I get all that stuff. It's cool that God sends this ark back out. They get it to the other side. They finally got it back. They got the tambourines and the music, and everybody's excited, and it's going back. And of course, whoa, they stumble, and the guy's like, hey, I got it. And then, but he's the one who dies? What in the world is going on here? That's not what this sermon is about, so I'm going to leave it where with you. I'll give away a couple things. You know, there was officially a way you were supposed to carry the ark. Like, there was a whole bunch of rules around the ark. You were supposed to carry it with these particular poles. Nobody was allowed to touch the ark because God is holy. He is set apart. And so you're not supposed to touch the ark. And so when they get the ark back and they put it on the back of a cart, this is basically the equivalent of you getting King Charles to visit your town, and you pick him up in the back of your like Ford F-150 pickup. And you say, come on, Charles, just hop in, brother. And you get him in there with all his robes and stuff. I can tell you right now, King Charles is not gonna be happy about that. We Americans are like, that's where you belong. That's not where kings belong. So to put the high and lifted up God on a cart where it can fall off and not obey the rules around the cart was a stupid idea to begin with. Because they were belittling their God, and they thought nothing of him, and they treated him as unholy. And when the Lord is treated as unholy, all manner of nonsense happens. Passages like this in the Old Testament only make sense if you understand the character trait of the holiness of God. And in our modern world, we think nobody is holy. There is nobody untouchable. People say, if I saw the president, I'd give him a piece of my mind. There's nobody high and lifted up. We are democratic people. And so we treat God kind of like our buddy. We talk to him the way that we would talk to a friend. When we think about him, we think the high and lifted up, almighty, sovereign, eternal Lord. He's the kind of guy I like to put my arm around or have him there on my bed to make me feel better when I'm crying. And yes, is he those things? Sure, but he's also high and lifted up. And if you don't get that, if you don't understand the holiness of God, in fact, if you don't start with the holiness of God, most of the Bible doesn't make any sense. You don't know why it is that when God's up on the mountain in Mount Sinai and he sends Moses to go up the top, he says to the people, don't approach the mountain. Not don't approach the top of the mountain, don't approach the mountain. Because if you touch it, you're going to die. Or why he says to Moses, Moses, the best of them, you can't see my face. The only way that you can see me and live is if I hide you in the rock and I pass by and you can look at the back. That's the only way. Because if you see me with your face, you're dead. We don't understand that because we struggle with the holiness of God. We struggle with the concept that God is high and lifted up and that he is morally pure. And we are not. What we need, like really what we need, is to see him like Isaiah did. And when I say that, I'm referring to one of the famous passages in all of the prophets, where Isaiah actually has a vision of the Lord on his throne, as he truly is. So what I want to do in the next few minutes is, actually, I want to talk, that was all an introduction to get you to Isaiah chapter 6. And I want to look in 13 verses, and I want to split it into two pieces, okay? And there's two things that we're going to learn in Isaiah 6, 1 to 13. Number one, God's holiness leads to despair. And second, God's mercy leads to dedication. God's holiness leads to despair, but his mercy leads to dedication. I love this passage of scripture. I hope you will too as we look at it. So let's start in Isaiah chapter 6, okay? God's holiness leads to despair. He says, in the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord. This guy here, King Uzziah, he actually was a really good king of Israel. If you go down through the book of Judges, you'll find out that there's a whole bunch of kings that were around for a number of years, and many of them, it says, they did not do, you know, right in the eyes of the Lord. Uzziah was not that guy. Uzziah was a good guy. He did right in the eyes of the Lord. He ruled for 52 years. He came to the throne at 16 years old, and the nation prospered really greatly under him. Everything was at peace. They had victory over their enemies, right? Which is what the Lord had said. If you follow my ways, you'll experience this prosperity. That's what he said to the nation of Israel. And so this guy did. And then he dies. And as soon as he dies, there's this vacuum that sort of exists in the leadership of the country. And they're not really sure who's going to be, you know, if the next king is going to be as good as him. And so, you know, all the people start kind of going off into their own way. And they're not sure that the prosperity of Israel is going to continue now that Uzziah is dead. And so they're like, okay, maybe we should, you know, hedge our bets by worshiping some of the other gods of the land. Yeah? So they do. And so Isaiah is troubled by all this worship of idolatry. And he says then, okay, then in that year, I saw the Lord. And here's what I saw. I saw him sitting on a throne, high and lifted up. The train of his robe filled the temple. The importance of a king or queen was always seen in the length of their garments. So some of you might have woken up years and years. Some of us are old enough to remember when Princess Diana became princess. Some it's Meghan Markle. Some it's like whatever. Those are the kind of the only princesses or the only royal family that we kind of have access to. But If you remember, they always have a shot kind of from above where she is walking. The princess is walking with the prince toward the altar, and their robe is just super, super, super long, right? Nobody has that length. Even ladies, when you got married, you did not have it. Even though you thought maybe, I want to be a princess, you did not get it all the way to the back. Because you'd be like, that's too ostentatious. It's a little bit over. It's a little bit crazy, right? Well, the train of the Lord's robe fills the temple. I just got to think about that. Like, it goes around and around, and it just keeps coming around and around. And the idea, of course, is that he is that exalted in terms of his importance. He's high and lifted up. The train of his robe, it fills the temple. And above him stood the seraphim. This word means burning one. So, like, fireballs. Flying fireballs, each have six wings. With two, they cover their face. Remember what I said about seeing the face of God? It doesn't just apply to human beings. He's too holy for them to look at. With two, he covered his feet. So they got wings here, they got wings here. And with two, they were flying. And one of them was calling to another. And they said, holy, holy, holy. That's three times holy, right? Which is greater than two times holy, right? Which is greater than one times holy. This is the way you intensify something in Hebrew, is you repeat it. You know, Jesus comes along and he says, truly, truly, I say to you. What is he trying to say? Hey, this is a really true statement. It's not just a true statement, it's a really true statement. In Hebrew, there's a section in the scriptures which talks about a guy falling into a pit. I didn't repeat myself because I didn't mean to. It's not just a pit, guys. It's a pit, which means what? It's a big pit, right? You dumb, hey? Right? It's not. You're not just dumb, you're dumb. We do it. We. Lord, I said it. I prayed, or the guy says, Lord, Lord, but you don't do what I say. You're not just the Lord. I believe that you're really the Lord, right? It's a repetition. But even in all of those examples, you're only here. Here, you're three times. He's holy, he's holy, holy, he's holy, holy, holy. And they sing this over and over and over and over. You think that our modern worship is bad. Over and over and over and over, back and forth to each other forever and ever and ever. Amen. Because never is it enough. Great church father Augustine used to say that. Nothing we say about you is enough. That's true. They never reach the actual holiness of God, even though they can say it forever and ever, amen. The holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory. And the foundations of the thresholds shook. So this means earthquake. At the voice of him who called, and the house was filled with smoke. I got to tell you, the two most frightening experiences for anybody who is inside at this time, okay, so like if you went inside of a building, the two most frightening experiences you would ever have would be number one, an earthquake, and number two, a fire. If you were in an earthquake, they did not build buildings well. They used to have old sayings about how in Rome, you could hear the apartment buildings falling down somewhere in Rome basically every day. So there weren't like building codes. You didn't have to get the guy to come in and say, you need to have a handrail there because someone's gonna fall. You just built. And if they fell down, they fell down. That's kind of the way it worked. And we in Chicago know what happens not that long ago when fire breaks out, when you don't have a very sophisticated fire department. It can ruin an entire city. So if you're in a building and it starts to shake, first thing in your mind is, I'm dead. Yeah? Because it's about to fall on me. The whole thing's about to fall on me. And number two, if there's smoke everywhere, you're thinking to yourself, I'm really dead. Because, you know, the fire guys aren't showing up through the door. the image that he's trying to get at through this whole section, he's trying to, Isaiah's basically saying, when I saw the Lord, I saw this magnificent, overwhelming vision of beauty and majesty that created a palpable, deep sense of fear for my very existence. And you've probably been in places where that's been the case before, maybe, in your life. I don't know, maybe you stood on a cliff, maybe you bungee jumped before. When you've looked out across the canyon and said, this is magnificent, and you looked down, and then they said, go, and they pushed you out. And that this sense of foreboding doom and magnificence sort of mixed together. I used to live in an area that you could take a ferry boat in. They would very rarely shut the ferries down, even in really bad weather. So whenever we'd see, my parents had a house that you could see the water, and you could watch the ferry go from, go to this town called Port Townsend in the Washington state. And when the weather got really bad, and my wife and I didn't have kids, we used to run down, well, not run, but we drove down the 5 minutes, 10 minutes to get to the ferry dock, park a car, get on the boat. So you get on the ferry boat when the waves were doing this, right? Really bad. But the ferries are not very big. So you'd stand out on the deck and you could lean over as far as you could and the wind would still blow you up and you could see the waves come up over the front and then the dip down. Oh, my word. Good fun when you're like, you know, 24, but now not so much. But there's this weird mixture of this is absolutely amazing and why are we doing this? We might die. And so Isaiah's in the midst of this. And his response to this image, this set of feelings, is I said, woe is me. Which is a funeral pronouncement. I'm dead. I'm lost. I'm a man of unclean lips. And I dwell in the midst of a people of unclean lips. For my eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts. It's important that you notice that it's his lips. I'll get to that in just a second. But his response is basically, I'm lost. And it's not because God is great in the sense that he's high and lifted up and beyond me and big and he can do lots of things. It's he's better, morally pure. Compared to him, I am wicked. You got to see something in the context of this passage. Is I actually really love this. If you go back to Isaiah chapter 5, notice what he does. I only picked out a few of these. There's a whole list of them. In Isaiah chapter 5, so the chapter right before this, notice what Isaiah is doing. He, see this word? Didn't he just say that about himself, right? But leading into it, he's not saying it about himself. He's saying it about all people of Israel, right? They're all, you know, running away from the Lord. And here's what he's decrying woes on there and basically saying, you're as good as dead. Woe to those who join house to house, who add field to field until there's no more room. In other words, people who gobble up all the land and they hoard it for themselves. Oh, woe to you. You're going to get it. That's what he's saying. Verse 20. Chapter 5, woe to those who call evil good and good evil, who put darkness for light and light for darkness, who put bitter for sweet and sweet for bitter. Those of you who are lying to yourselves, thinking that way that you're acting is actually good, but it's evil. Think about our political world now, where it's like, no, 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 I'm doing the righteous thing. No, you're not, it's wicked. No, who are you to say it's wicked? Woe to you, oh, you're gonna get it. Wait till the Lord comes, you're gonna get it. That's what he's saying. The next verse, woe to those who are wise in their own eyes and shrewd in their own sight. They're so self-righteous and think of themselves as the only one who's got the right answer. Oh, wait till God shows up because then you're going to see. That's what he's saying. Woe to those, verse 22 and 23, who are heroes at drinking wine and valiant men in mixing strong drink. Isn't that great? There are some people in the world who are heroes at drinking wine. I've known a few. right? Valiant men in mixing strong drink. Oh, you're a hero. Who acquit the guilty for a bribe and deprive the innocent of his right. They're men for sale. Oh, wait till God comes. You think that you're getting away from it with it right now, but when the Lord comes, woe to you. You can just see Isaiah's fingers pointed straight out at all the people. This is the good fun for a prophet. And then in Isaiah 6:5, he says, and I said, woe is who? What changed? Well, the answer is he saw the Lord, right? And this is a really important point. The only way that righteous Isaiah can exist is if he never sees true righteousness. The only way self-righteousness can exist in the world today is if you're only comparing yourself to other people kind of on a bell curve, right? Well, I'm better than everyone else. They're gonna get it. You're all gonna get it. But then he sees the Lord and going, I'm gonna get it. I'm totally gonna get it. It's like if Big Brother goes and says, little brother, we're going to have a race, you and me. Little brother's like, I'm going to beat you. And big brother goes, no, you got no chance. And they go out and they start racing. And of course, big brother wins because he pushes him over and he finishes and he comes back and he taunts little brother. No, you stink. Big brother's just fine as long as he's only racing little brother. As long as that's the standard. The moment Noah Lyles or, you know, Usain Bolt shows up, guess what big brother is? Nothing. He's nothing. Everything depends on the standard. Everything depends upon the standard. And listen very closely to me. Human beings, you and me, are not judged based upon whether or not we're a little bit better than our neighbor. We're judged based upon whether we're perfect as our Heavenly Father is perfect. That is the moral standard. When it's that standard, you and I are no longer capable of actually going out and pointing our fingers at everyone all the time. We're so consumed with our own wickedness. When we realize how holy God is, we don't have time to start pointing out everyone else's flaws. This is why God's holiness is such a central part of living as a Christian. Folks, I don't know why it is that Christians forget this. I've preached in enough churches that one of my favorite things people do is they give the elbow of conviction to their friend. You know, you say something about it, and they're like, see, listen, are you listening to that, honey, right now? You don't think I can see. I see everything. This is like the best spot for all this stuff. Afterwards, sometimes people will come to me, and they'll say, oh, I wish my friend were here. Why? They really needed to hear that. Cool. Which part? Oh, the part about sin, because they're sinners. And I'm like, yeah, maybe. And what are you, though? But I can't say, it's not a good pastor thing to say, right? Which is why, you know, I almost didn't get a job at one point because I had the meeting, and when they heard me preach, and they say, you're kind of too prophetic. And by that, they meant you'd be not easy to talk to afterwards because you want to ask questions about whether that applies to you. Christian self-righteousness is a genuine problem. But it's only a genuine problem because we don't keep our eyes on the holy God. It's a problem because we keep our eyes on the unholy masses. Woe is you, woe is you, woe is you. No, woe is me. Woe is me. I am undone. So like I said, God's holiness creates despair. Being a Christian is awesome, though, because we are good news people. And we have a God of good news. The bad news is that we're desperately wicked. The good news is a theological word called atonement. And this is a passage that talks about it. So God's mercy creates dedication. Notice what happens next, verse 6. One of the seraphim flew to me, having in his hand a burning coal that he had taken with tongs from the altar on which God sat, right? So this is a stone, a burning coal, that was adjacent to the Lord. And it carries with it the moral quality somehow of the Lord. And he touched my mouth with it. You guys notice what's happening here? Wait, he couldn't. He says, woe to me, I'm a man of unclean lips, right? I live among a people of unclean lips. And he said those words after he heard these angels declaring back and forth to each other, holy, holy, holy is the Lord Almighty. And then when the angel comes, he touches his mouth and he said, behold, this has touched your lips. Your guilt is taken away and your sin atoned for. The first thing you need to notice is his problem is guilt, is moral weakness. He's not morally good enough to even stand in this. And again, it has everything to do with standards. Man, I remember when I was in a high school or a college, I came home. I was not good at doing laundry in college. What boy is at all? So I remember coming home to my house and I had worn, you know, I had washed my clothes, but I came home and I remember my mom taking out part of the laundry that I had washed, and it was my socks. And she set them aside and she said, what have you done with the socks? And I'm like, what do you mean? I washed them. She said, honestly, Jeff, I feel like I could, they're like hammers. I could, you know, they're so stiff. You can't, she'd hold them up. They're not moving, right? They're so gross and they're crusty and stuff. And I'm like, they're not gross. They're not that bad at all. Yeah, and she had a whole bunch of them and they all looked the same. Anyway, she went out and bought me new socks. And she came back. She didn't do anything with those. She came back and she put them, no kidding, on top of the washing machine. And I remember walking in and looking at those new socks and then looking at the old ones and going, ooh. I was totally willing to wear those old socks until I saw the beauty of the new socks. Because the standard, the real standard of white and new and purity was there. And then the idea of keeping these old socks and putting them on felt so gross. Right. This is Isaiah's problem, is that compared to everybody else, he looks perfectly fine to wear. But compared to the holy God, all he wants to do is hide and leave and somehow get away from the moral stare of a righteous God because he's so not righteous. And so God goes and he gets this coal and he touches his mouth with it, which is the word atonement. There is nothing in Isaiah that draws God's attention for this, yes? God doesn't look at Isaiah and think, man, if you were on my team, we'd really win the game. This is a completely one-sided action on his part. And guys, this is what grace is. I've told you this story before. It's in the Old Testament. It's one of my favorite stories in the whole Bible. It's about David and Mephibosheth. It's a funny name. Mephibosheth was Jonathan's son, Saul's grandson. But Saul and Jonathan died in a battle. And when they died, Mephibosheth, who would have been the next in line to be the king, was only a little guy, and they picked him up and dropped him when they were running away as fast as they could, because, you know, when the new king comes in, the first order of business is to kill the old kings and everybody in his line. And so Mephibosheth was next in line, and so his nursemaid grabbed him, dropped him, and they were never able to fix his leg. So he grew up being lame, crippled. And in an agrarian society, okay, like you have to do farming or, you know, manual labor, you don't get to sit behind the desk and work because you've got a bad leg. You're basically useless. This is why there were so many people with bad legs who would be on the side of the road. Jesus goes and he heals the lame so often because the lame are out there because they're useless in that kind of society. So this guy, he moves way off in this place called Lodabar, which is way off in the middle of nowhere, so no one could ever find him. But then David decides he's going to go looking for him. He does. He finds the guy. They come up to his house and say, "Hey, Mephibosheth, come, King David wants you." And what does he think David wants? To kill me. So he gets in the little carriage. They take him back to the city in Jerusalem. David says he's in the throne room, the high and mighty throne room, and Mephibosheth comes limping in, knowing that his hours are likely numbered. And he comes to David and he says, "What is it that you want with a dead dog like me? I am nothing. I am worse than an animal. Just, what? I'm as good as dead now. I pose no threat to you at all. Just let me alone." But he knows that this is not the way it works. You're supposed to kill off those in line. So he thinks that's what's going to happen. But David says, "No, for the sake of the promise that I made to your father, Jonathan, I want to bless you. And I'm going to restore to you all the lands and all of the things that were your grandfather Saul's." And so he takes this useless, deserving of death human being, and he takes him into his own house and he treats him as his own son. The last line of the whole story is this in 2 Samuel 9. Mephibosheth lived in Jerusalem and he ate always, always at the king's table. Is there a greater sign of sonship than being able to boldly go in and sit next to the king and have the same food as him? The same tablecloth that covered the legs, the working legs of the king, fell across the crippled legs of Mephibosheth. And he was lame in both his feet. And the reason he's saying that is he shouldn't have been there. He didn't deserve it. He deserved to be killed. And yet, God, this is our story, right? As Christian people, don't you realize that our moral filth meant that we should not have been redeemed. There was nothing about us that drew God's attention to us. He did not see in us some potential or some movement towards something and think, "Well, they're moving that way, so I'll get in line." No, he reached out and he grabbed the morally filthy and restored it, redeemed it, brought it into his home and made it his child forever and ever and ever. Amen. So that you and I, through all the ages, will sit at the table of the king, lame in our feet, and know we do not belong there. And yet that's our story. That's where we've been. Now, this is what's happened to Isaiah. The morally filthy has been redeemed. So what does that do to you? When you realize that that's a thing that God has done, when you really, really understand how deep the grace of God goes, or when God answers Paul's prayer when he said that they might know how deep and wide and high and deep is the love of Christ. Why is he praying for you to know the love of Christ? Because if you really knew the love of Christ, it would affect you in ways that you cannot even imagine. How? Okay, well, let's have a look at what it did to Isaiah. If I can get it to work. Here it is, verse 8. God has touched his lips. And I heard the voice of the Lord saying, "Whom shall I send? And who will go for us?" And then I said with my lips, out of my mouth, because Isaiah this whole time has been wanting to join in with the angels. "Yes, you're holy, you're holy, you're holy." But he can't, because the words have to go through immoral lips to get out there. So God comes and he touches his lips, purifies them. And the first thing he says is not a worship song. What is it? "Send me. Here I am. Send me." To do what? Go and say to this people, "Keep on hearing, but do not understand. Keep on seeing, but do not perceive. Make the heart of this people dull, their ears heavy, and blind their eyes, lest they see with their eyes and hear with their ears and understand with their hearts and turn and be healed. Guys, here's what I want from you, Isaiah. I'm gonna actually turn you into a prophet who never sees the results of his prophecies, but just everyone hates so much. They used to have a missions day at my seminary. I remember walking through the foyer, and there was all these mission booths for all these different places. Can you imagine standing at the mission booth, and you're going to sell your mission to one of these seminary students? They walk up, and they're like, hey, I want to be involved in missions to Europe. And they say, cool, here's what it's going to require. You're going to go out, and you're going to preach, and everyone you preach to will want to kill you. Oh, and what would your question be immediately after that? How long? A month? A couple weeks? I can do that for a couple weeks, right? And then see the deliverance of the Lord come. Well, here's the answer. Until cities lie waste without inhabitant. So until my judgment comes upon the city so completely that they're desolate. Houses are without people, and the land is a desolate waste, and the Lord removes people far away, and the forsaken places are many in the midst of the land, meaning that there's just places you go, and there's no one there, like those cities in China that they just built and everyone left. And though a tenth remain, right? We're going to get down to a tenth, but even then, it's going to be burned again. Like a terebinth or an oak whose stump remains when it's felled. But Isaiah, the holy seed is the stump. But you, Isaiah, your ministry is basically going to be one of devastation. That's what I want from you. I want you to give your life as a full sacrifice for the judgment of people, not seeing the outcome of your ministry. You guys know, Isaiah dies by being, history says, being sawn in two after this. So you're going to be sawn in half after having no fruit in your ministry. People aren't coming to faith. They're running away and throwing things at you, want to kill you. But you'll be serving a purpose in my plan. Who in the world does that kind of ministry work? And the answer is the one who understands how much the atonement meant. I think I've said this to you before, that there is a very important mental understanding that Christians need to have if we're going to live robust Christian lives. In your mind, there is an understanding of the gap between what you deserved from the Lord and what you've received. Okay? That there exists a gap. For a lot of people, they think, well, I was a really good person. So what I deserve from the Lord was, yeah, okay, I get it, I'm a sinner, But, you know, what I deserve from the Lord was, you know, like 90% of the stuff. And then the Lord came and he gave the 10%. And so they have this gap that exists. I will call that your worship gap. Because if that is the gap in your life, this is how big your worship will be. Worship is always a response to who God is and what he's done. And so your worship, and again, not just singing, but the sacrifice you make in your life will be that big. But listen, if you really, really understand that what you deserved because of your and my moral filth was so little. In fact, we deserve nothing. We deserve damnation, eternal damnation. But what you've received is you get to sit with the King every day. The gap is enormous. And if you have that gap, your money is meaningless. It's only there for God. If you have that gap, servant-heartedness and generosity and sacrificing for others is nothing, because
You owe him so much. You owe him so much. You could never give enough to warrant this. You could never sing holy, holy enough to warrant this.
So one of the biggest questions in the minds, or in your mind, is how big is the gap? So let me finish by reading you a passage that essentially asks that question. It's in Luke chapter 7. Jesus answered a Pharisee who had him at dinner. And this sinful woman came in with her hair going everywhere, and she lays down in front of Jesus' feet, and she breaks her alabaster jar open, and all of her perfume goes onto his feet. This is the most expensive thing she owns, just everywhere. And the Pharisee at the end, Simon, looks at him and thinks to himself, if he knew who she was, he wouldn't let her touch him. True prophets are never touched by women like this. Shame by association, folks. And so Jesus answered him. The guy didn't ask Jesus anything. Jesus just knew what he was thinking. So Jesus said to him, Simon, I have something to say to you. And he answered, say it, teacher. Well, a certain moneylender had two debtors. One owed him 500 denarii, that's 500 daily wages. So whatever it is that you make, times 500, your daily wage plus five times 500. And when they could not pay, he canceled the debt of both. One, 500, one, 50. Now, which of them will love him more? And Simon answered, well, the one, I suppose, for whom he canceled the larger debt. And he said to him, you've judged rightly. And then turning toward the woman, he says to Simon, do you see this woman? I entered your house. You gave me no water for my feet, but she's wet my feet with her tears and wiped them with her hair. You gave me no kiss. But from the time I came in, she's not ceased to kiss my feet. You didn't anoint my head with oil, but she's anointed my feet with ointment. Therefore, I tell you, this all is evidence that her sins, which she knows are many, are forgiven. I can tell that she knows her sins are forgiven because of what she's doing right now. For she loved much. But he who is forgiven little, or he who thinks he's forgiven little, Simon, loves little. So when I ask you the question, how big is the gap? I can tell by what your worship looks like. Everybody can tell by how your worship looks. So how's your worship? Simon-sized? Sinner-sized? Let me pray. Lord, I'm thankful for a little passage of scripture in the Old Testament that reminds us of the great truths of the atonement and warnings against self-righteousness, but mostly, Father, I'm thankful for the knowledge that the key to greater worship is tied to a right understanding of the gospel and forgiveness. So Lord, I pray that you would overwhelm us. Honestly, you'd overwhelm us with your moral superiority and holiness. It's not something we talk about. It's certainly not something we feel, and yet it is so central to us being the kinds of Christians that we know you've called us to be. Father, we need that vision. We need the sense of the atonement and what you've done for us so that we can live lives that are not grounded in some kind of like begrudging duty, but actually are grounded in joy and delight because of the gospel. Would you make us like this woman? Would you help us to be scandalous in the way that we act toward you? Because it certainly is scandalous how you've acted toward us. Spirit, come, make it true among us, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Would you stand with us then and respond?
If it's bandaging the broken or washing filthy feet, here I am, Lord, send me. If it's loving one another, even when we don't agree, here I am, Lord, send me.
If I'm poor, if I'm wealthy, I'll serve you just the same. Here I am, Lord, send me. On the mountain or the valley, I will choose to praise. Here I am, Lord, send me.
If I'm known by how I live, let my life reflect how much I love you. I love you. And before you even ask, oh, my answer will be yes, 'cause I love you. I love you. If the truth cuts like an arrow, I will say it anyway, 'cause here I am, Lord, send me. If it means that they'll reject me, Lord, I will still obey, 'cause here I am, Lord, send me. If I'm known by how I love, let my life reflect how much I love you. I love you. And before you even ask, oh, my answer will be yes, 'cause I love you. I love you.
I'm standing in your glory, I'll be glad I chose to say that here I am, Lord, send me. Well done, good and faithful, I live to hear you say, here I am.
Well, I think all of us can be a little forgetful sometimes. When I think of myself, it's crazy how often I forget how big the gap is. How could I forget how wicked my heart is? How could I forget how great and pure and beautiful God is? How could we forget these things? We're not thinking about it. We're not spending time with Him. And I know if you're like me, our response to this sermon could be, well, if I show how much the gap is by how much I worship, then I know, yeah, I should be doing more. Which might be true, but the response is not, I'm gonna go and do a bunch of things now for God. The response is sit with Him and be reminded how big that gap is. Don't brush over it. Sit in it. Reflect on your own sin. Reflect on the purity and the holiness of God. And remember, despite how big the gap is, He sent Jesus for me. And He gave His life for me. So what wouldn't I do for Him? There's no one who's willing to do for you what God has done for you. And we get to reflect Him to the world around us. So sit in that, and as a response, let's show what our worship is like. Let's show to the world around us who our God is. And look, if there's something particular that's going on in your life that you're having a hard time turning away from, showing your worship to God in, and you want somebody to walk through that with you, you want somebody to pray with you, or you have something on your mind that you just need prayer for, we're going to have people right up front come and receive prayer. You're not alone. And if you're new to Harvest, whether this is your first time or you've been coming for a while, I would love to talk to you in the lobby. But even beyond that, we have something called Discover Harvest in our Hope Center right across the lobby, where you can learn more about our church and the kinds of ways that you can be involved here. We would love for you to come pop in and join us for just a few minutes after the service, and we'll just chat for a little while. It's a great opportunity. But for all of us, as you go out today on mission for the Lord, to reflect Him wherever you go, remember that you are loved.